Thank you, Representative Ellison and Representative Buchanan. I guess he had to run off, but I appreciate the opportunity to be here at the briefing today. I want to make two main points. First off, that it's not a trade deal, and I say that in my, you know, again, Representative Ellison said that, Melissa said this, but I think it's really important to emphasize, because there's a lot of people in Washington who think you have to support a trade deal, otherwise you're a Neanderthal, so it's not a trade deal. There's very little about trade here. This is about regulation. Second point is that there is no Team America, and I say this because you have this idea, and certainly it comes up in the TPP, and it will come up with this, that, you know, we're all in this, you know, Donald Trump's out there, you know, we have stupid trade negotiators. Now, I don't think they're stupid, I don't know most of them, but, you know, I'm willing to believe they're not stupid. But the point is, they're working for different interests, and it's not Team America. You have some interests that might benefit from this deal, other deals, others who will be harmed by it. Okay, first off, you know, the argument about it not being a trade deal, well, trade, you know, it's about eliminating tariff barriers, you know, and there basically are none. I mean, the average tariff barrier between the U.S. and Europe is less than 1%. You know, the idea was we had to get rid of those. You know, we just call them up and go, you want to get rid of the tariff? You know, I mean, this is stupid. You know, this is not going to affect anything. So the tariffs are not an issue. I should point out, it's a pretty similar story with the TPP. I mean, the Peterson Institute and their analysis that got all this play, I should point out, they actually did not show very large gains. They showed half a percentage point of GDP, so that means that if we pass the deal and they're right, we'd be as rich on January 1st, 2030 as we would otherwise be on March 15th, 2030. Not zero, but, you know, a little hard to get too excited about that. But in any case, in their analysis, they say the vast majority of the gains they're imputing to the United States have nothing to do with tariffs. Less than 10% of that was tariffs. In this case, it would be even less than that. So the tariffs are just a non-issue. So the idea of this being about trade, no, it's not a trade deal. It's about a regulatory structure, as Melissa and Representative Ellison were just saying. So the question is, what are the regulations we're talking about? And again, this is all about creating more corporate-friendly regulations. It's not to say we don't have bad regulations. Of course we do. But is this a better way to get rid of bad regulations? And again, when you look at the standard economic analyses of the deal, invariably, the vast majority of the gains to a country come from getting rid of its own regulations. Okay, so to take an example that, you know, is coming up in the debate, I don't know where, you know, where their trade negotiations stand right now, but we want, you know, Europe to have more access to our GMOs. So how would that be modeled? Well, if we could force Europe to, you know, more easily take our GMOs, not label products, not mandate labeling, as is generally the case, well, that would be a gain to France and Germany, because they would record that as cheaper food. You know, that's how they would report that. Now, we'd have a really small gain. Monsanto's going to have higher profits. Okay, so if you're a shareholder in Monsanto, that would look good. But, you know, the rest of us, you know, wouldn't see anything from that. So the gains will almost invariably be to the country that gets rid of the regulation, which, of course, we could have done without the TTIP. Okay, so if we have this really stupid regulation, we're stupid fools, and we're requiring people to label products for GMOs when there's no reason to do that, well, we could do that without the TTIP. Okay, so the question is, do we need a trade deal to force that? And again, this is unilaterally, it's simply making the regulations harder. So we will have weaker health and safety regulations, weaker environmental regulations. There is zero in here that will make them stronger. So the question is, when you look across the panoply of regulation, do we think that we're too heavily regulated for safety and environment? Just to take a crude example, but what the hell, we're crude here when we talk about trade. This will make another Flint easier, okay? Because it'll be harder to impose the sort of regulations that would prevent a Flint. Okay, that's harsh, perhaps, but that's true. And, you know, I'll challenge anyone who wants to argue the opposite. Okay, the Team America point. This is a simple story here. A lot of this is about requiring stronger and longer patent and copyright protections. That's great if you're Pfizer. That's great if you're Disney. For the rest of us, not only is it not great, it's bad. Okay, and here, you know, I'm really going to pick on the Peterson Institute model because it's very, very useful here. Peterson Institute model and the TPP, it's a standard trade model. I'm just picking on them because, you know, they got in all the news about this. It's a standard trade model, and they say that, you know, getting these regulations does not affect the trade balance. For those of us who go, oh my God, we got $500 billion trade deficit, all of a sudden, nothing to do with the trade deal. Okay, well, we get these big deficits, but nothing to do with the trade deal is interesting. But anyhow, that aside, does not affect the trade balance. Okay, very simple point of logic here. If our trade balance doesn't change, and Pfizer and Merck are getting a lot more money for their drugs, and Disney's getting more money for their movies and whatever else, what does that mean about manufactured with everything else we sell. Balance hasn't changed. We have a larger deficit then on manufacturing goods and everything else. Logically follows. There is no way around that. Okay, well, that's my point about Team America. If we have President Obama, as he is doing, he's going on saying, oh, we're going to get better prices, our drug companies are going to get better prices for their drugs, that means the rest of us are going to see a larger trade deficit in manufactured goods. Okay, to my mind, that's not a good story. That's not the direction we want to go in. And I should also point out, I'm saying that from the standpoint of workers here, I'm not happy to see them pay higher drug prices. You know, the system we have of supporting drugs, patent protection, is utterly absurd. I go on for hours on that, but I'll just say, you look at a drug like Sovaldi that's marketed at $84,000, hepatitis C drug. It's produced in India. Generic companies can sell it profitably for a few hundred dollars. Can you think of anything more absurd? Here you have someone that's hepatitis C. They're suffering from hepatitis C. We're going, why don't you figure out how you can come up with $84,000 when it actually costs a few hundred dollars? That's all because of the patent monopoly. That is a really, really stupid thing. So that's a bit of a digression. I don't like what we're doing in Europe with that either, in other words. Okay, but the last point. And, again, we have all these people in Washington, and the elites around the country go, oh, my God, we have this horrible problem of income inequality. What can we do about it? Okay, what happens when you have stronger and longer patent protection? You know any poor people who have unemployed workers have patents? I don't. I don't think you have many. Patent protection redistributes income upward. Okay, it's pretty damn stupid if we're trying to fight income inequality to constantly have policies that redistribute more income upwards. The rest of us pay more for drugs. Pfizer and its top scientists get more money for their patents. That is really stupid policy. Okay, so this gets back to the idea of Team America. This is not about Team America. It's about Team 1%. And to my view, we don't need trade deals like that.